running her own trust, which is Vikas Charitable Trust, which has a school, a primary healthcare center, and works for 40 schools around the factory in Kirloskar Wadi. I have had an opportunity to visit Kirloskar Wadi a few years back. It's something remarkable. I think the family has done a lot for the farming community. And I understand that Pradhima Kirloskar's initiative has helped a lot of industries to come out with very useful products for the farming community, not only in India. And I understand her work has really helped Cambodia in achieving self-sufficiency in rice cultivation. And I personally feel that I'm thankful for you to, conduct this meeting for us in Thai, because we are also in a very challenging time in Kerala. Our land holdings are small, and we are expecting large number of NRIs coming back from Gulf countries, and we'll have to provide opportunity for them. And small land holdings, naturally, they will have to cultivate unless they have some useful instruments. That will be a challenge. And I understand, ma'am, that with your initiative, Kirloskar, your company itself has developed a lot of new products like pump sets and electricity generating motors and all that. Now, may I request you to give a presentation to us, which I am sure will be of great help. Thank you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can I have my presentation loaded, please? So our journey has had, well, many ups and downs. So what has kept us abreast is our creativity and innovative ability, which has allowed us to survive two pandemics. Next slide, please. Innovation and history have always been like Siamese twins. One makes the other. Either you write history by using disruption or radical innovation, or become history due to the lack of it. Apple is an example of being on both sides of this divide at one point or the other. From being the best, it slipped, then reinvented itself to bounce back to its original position today. So in fact, all these companies on the right-hand side were very innovative companies at one point of time. So innovation is a continuous process. Next slide, please. Innovation for and by the remaining 70% of Indians who live in rural areas. They come from small towns and cities. Yet, innovation is always attributed to an Apple Watch, Uber, Amazon, or drones for military surveillance. How about a YouTube channel called Papa and Mummy Kitchen, getting 1.5 million views, and a tourist taxi driver from Rajasthan who got thousands of trips using a 1 minute video on YouTube. Or better still, is a weather data logger, which has simply reduced the price tag of a weather data log from $4,000 to 4,000 rupees. Next slide, please. The fallout of COVID, and what has COVID taught me? It seems it sees no boundaries while spreading. However, it contains us in our boundaries. Most rural folk went back to their villages and may not come back so soon. Most people from rural India have very small parcels of land that they live off. Some of their family members go to cities to get additional income to maintain a reasonable standard of living. This leaves us with two options. Can we use all the constraints that villages have to start a viable business? When all the food comes from rural India, the markets are densely populated urban cities. Even though the pandemic, and also the pandemic, essential services were allowed to move while non-essential services stopped. So I see an opportunity here. Next slide, please. If your product is food, less disruption can happen. Unless you find a substitute for food. you can disrupt delivery, you can disrupt payment systems, systems to produce, irrigate fields, but the end product will stay the same. Quite the opposite with desktops, which change to laptops, which change to phones, or servers, which change to the cloud, or from buying products to on-demand products to subscription for products. Next slide, please. Rural India may still present some opportunities. If you see the landscape, I would bucket it into five categories, all moving around agriculture, as that is the biggest industry. I will talk on the innovative parts only and not livelihood. While there are power tillers, new variety of seeds, organic fertilizers to enhance production, I will focus on automation of processes and some new thoughts. So coming to my categories, water and electricity, roads, logistics and marketing, tourism and local cuisine, health and education, financial services, bachat ghats and microfinance. Next slide, please. Water is one of the essences of agriculture. Now, in villages, electricity, however, though it is free, it's uncertain. The result is pumps are run continuously until they sometimes run dry and the motor burns, or the water table gets depleted. There's tremendous wastage of water. Now, can we automate the system with sensors checking for humidity, or use another source of energy to run the pump? Yes, in some there is some technology to do that, without power and internet, then releasing water stored in a water harvested tank, thereby using only what is needed. So there are pumps that run on solar power and push the electricity not used to run the pump to the grid or to a battery to use later. There are also pumps that can utilize small waterfalls to generate electricity. An 18 feet drop could do this job. Next slide. Imagine a logistics company carrying a mini industrial fruit and food processor, parking it at the farm and processing the fruit to jam and fruit juices while processing the vegetables to pre-chopped and cooked food. It can then go from one village to another, canning or bottling the ingredients. Another van can do just labeling for all. Finally, the van can be taken directly to a local urban retailer or home delivery. Services come to an individual farm and help create the end product. So think of decentralizing during this time, keeping small capacities, ensuring your utilization is 100%. It's a shared resource and economical. So I think we need to do what suits our size. Logistics companies can morph a bit to seize this market opportunity. A possibility too, the same process could be done in a very high-tech way. Let's take a vertically integrated food processing business. Now, fruits seem such a prosaic item, but you can witness a whole horde of technologies from end to end. Sensors on the field to gauge water content in the fruit, monitored by drones, the plucking of the fruit with innovative implements, and loading them in a truck that has a tracking device fitted in it, cold chains and logistics to carry them to factories, all monitored by real-time tracking software, geofencing the route, safety in driving, and what have you. Now, delivering the fruits to the processing plant, which is again automatically captured by the ERP. After that, every step of processing can be automated until the food is packed and leaves the factory. Now, various routes for the end destination comes from a front-end technology that determines real-time demand, making sure the turnaround time is minimum and the product reaches the rack for sale. Next slide, please. Think of tourism and some possibilities. If flying becomes cumbersome, where can you go? Escape from the city for a day trip? There are no places, one may say. But think again. With the diversity India has, we could create picnic spots that are just 1 hour away. We have several forts, water bodies, forests surrounding our cities. So beautiful tea rooms could be set up on plantations, and that would be a welcome. India, with this diversity of trees and terrain, offers plenty of opportunities for bird watching identifying trees, flora, fauna, an observatory that gives details of biodiversity with pictures and commentary could be set up. Children love the simple pleasures of life. Visiting artisans, woodwork, stonework, temple architecture, experience centers for woodwork, etc., would be a unique place to go. If we create interesting activities for all ages, the entire family would enjoy the outing. If we put together some basic amenities and facilities for such day picnics, where one can eat clean local cuisine, drink clean water, enjoy nature, and come back in the evening refreshed. By doing so, you create opportunities, you create jobs for the nearby villagers to train people in hospitality, housekeeping, running a local rural kitchen with modern concept of cleanliness and transparency. Temples, chanting, meditation, Ayurveda treatments, all could be part of this rural tourism. And India is so famous for this, I think we should cash in on it. In one of your day trips, you could actually bring back fresh from the farm, vegetables and farm products. Think about getting fresh vegetables, honey, fruit, milk products, flowers to your doorstep, right from the farm. So from the farm to the table. Today, the government of Maharashtra has opened up the vegetable market and permitted any farmer to take vegetables to the cities directly to the customer without the need of the middleman, without the need to go to a busy, dirty market. Next slide, please. There have been innovative products even in the health and education sector. So one of the suggestions was pathological testing and collection centers in villages. Path lab collection centers in villages for some of the tricky tests, while most of the others could be done in the local path lab. If basic diagnostics can move to rural India, it will enable them to conveniently do basic tests. Even the complicated ones can be done in their village at some point later. They would need to travel only for emergencies, complications, or serious sicknesses to urban hospitals for treatment and hospitalization. There was a company that did diagnostics for eyes called Inetra, which made goggles that you could wear and read to check if you had an eye power. If you need glasses, they can be ordered. And if not, there was no further checkup unless you complain of more symptoms or your reading test picks up some strange facts that may need surgery. In that case, you are referred to the nearest hospital. Think about the other one, drone ambulances. Can become the next disruptive innovation in the healthcare sector. Drones can improve the way we think about medical emergencies. They can be used for delivering medicines from the pharmacy to your doorstep, or at a later date perhaps, transferring organs from one hospital to another. To provide villages with essential medical supplies, all we need to do is to map India's 2,50,000 gram panchayats with drones, mapped to the nearest pharmacy. Important supplies can be delivered to patients suffering from road accidents or sometime in the future, an enhanced version of drone, which can carry people from a spot location to the nearest hospital. On the education side, there was one rural innovative method of learning called 100 days of school. So farmers are too poor to pay for labor. Their children become their labor and assist in farming. However, they have about 100 days free between sowing and reaping, where they could go to a so-called gurukul and stay with the teacher to pursue their education up to the 10th grade. So they do 100 days a year. They do this at their pace, quite like the Japanese Kumon system of math, where although you are in the same class, you are at different levels of math. They may finish the 10th grade at age 15 or may not finish it at 15. And they may finish at 20, but they will complete it. We had funded this concept. We need to tweak processes to suit our unique needs. On the other hand, with COVID, there are some schools that did go online. This could be another way to study. The school comes to you and you go to the school only to solve problems. Before COVID, I had imagined that the multiplexes we have could become multidisciplinary universities. Each university could book a slot to teach. Well, however, that could not be done because COVID has come, and I think that's a bad idea. Next slide. there is a lot of innovation in financial services. And this sometimes can be a backbone for most villages. Globally, farmers plan their cropping pattern based on prices available on the futures exchange. Japan too has an exchange called the Topom, which is a benchmark for rubber prices. This predicts the prices of rubber in the next 3 months using predictive analysis. Perhaps one may defer sale of rubber if it predicts a better price in 3 months. Why can't we develop one for other crops like pineapples, spices, coffee, tea? Microfinance, Bachat Ghat, and financial services. While microfinance and Bachat Ghat are commonplace, you find them in all villages. The new age financial services that aggregate information of the buyer from various platforms that he uses, whether it's his phone or whether it's WhatsApp, whether it's Facebook, enables you to make a quick decision about his creditworthiness. Then the loans are sanctioned, and this could be done in 30 seconds. It may be possible to aggregate all such services on a mobile app where the back end is connected across all the rural financial institutions to enable an individual to choose any card facility he has on a common platform and make payments either in his village or in the city using his mobile phone. So essentially, his mobile phone is the card, and it has several cards all in the same mobile phone. Another thought was, all our back office service work can move to rural India now because talent is moving back to the villages. Perhaps you can even make it cheaper. Given the size of population in rural India, there are unlimited possibilities. With Bachat Ghat, microfinance, once you add a layer of disruptive technology to it. Next slide, please. However, there are some myths around innovation. Here, sustainable innovation. People often think innovation costs a lot of money. Let me give you an example of a simple solution related to purifying water. A farmer's son was able to develop a zero electricity water purifier, which could filter 500 liters of water every day. He used a sedimentation method with many layers of filtration. It should be common sense. Innovation does not require that you need to always think out of the box. It could be as simple as using plastic bottles on the roof to light a house, or using the roller water cans to transport water. Institutionalize innovation. A Pune-based company called KPIT has smartly thrown open innovation to thousands of engineering colleges with a sharp problem statement. They have now institutionalized the innovation process by well-defined problem statements, briefing the students and inspiring to think out of the box. This is bundled with well-documented standard operating procedures for filtering ideas and curating the most innovative one. Look around. There are people who have ideas similar to yours and possibly solve challenges that you are facing while working on a solution. Why reinvent the wheel when someone else has already done it? Collaboration and cooperation is the mantra to save time and valuable resource today. Constant innovation. Innovation is evolving and expanding its reach day by day. Process innovation is a continuous process, while product innovations are usually disruptive and radical. Next slide. There are many online communities for innovation now. Twitter, there's loads of innovators. Next slide, please. Loads of innovators are on this platform as it helps tag others of similar interests, and search is relatively easy using hashtag. I think you moved one up. Yeah, no, that's fine. YouTube, you subscribe to channels as videos are the fastest way you can learn. Facebook, the group feature of Facebook should be leveraged to join like-minded communities. LinkedIn, almost similar to Facebook, a LinkedIn group would help you get in touch with investors, customers, and future talent in your team. Websites. A few good websites have huge repository of content, much needed in the decision-making process. And books, a priceless reservoir of knowledge, which contains pre-Google era information. So I think I will stop here. we could go into our discussion or our questions. And then I will move on to the slides that we have done, which Kirloskar Brothers has done. So I think we will do that last.
That would be useful, yes.
Yeah, then when we finish our discussion, maybe I could revisit those slides. So we could just hold the presentation where it is right now and continue with our discussion. So would we,
hello.
Yes, would you be taking us through the questions?
Hello.
Would you be taking us through the questions?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hello. Yeah.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. Any questions, please?
Actually, they have posted some questions. There is one open question. It says, slide 8 has mentioned ERP. Is there an end-to-end ERP that fits the entire process to connect the farmer to the customer? I don't think there is one yet that takes you from the farmer to the customer, but this could be a totally integrated one which can be done. We have ideas like this spread. Are there organizations to collate this and support the individual? May I answer this? Hello?
Yeah, go ahead, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, so, so I think it is possible to do this. We are working on some of these ideas, and actually some of them are very simple to do. So it is a question of just having the idea. And I think most of the other ingredients are already available. But putting it together, and there have been some people who have some softwares who have done it in the past. They failed, but they would join. So yes, it is possible to do this. So are they?
Can you hear me?
Yeah. Any views on IBM Food Trust? Not really. But they have something called a Chopal, which they have done with ITC, where they are helping farmers to give them better plants and seeds so that they have long resistant kind of plants in there, which they are doing a buyback with, I think. I have fully sustainable farming system developed with 100% sustainable electricity and fully sensor-enabled processing. How to take this to a larger level? I am not saying I have an idea. I have a working system running for the last 1 year. It's a model with 100 square meter size with integrated farming. Is this person based in Kerala?
I don't think so.
Okay, but you know, I have given my email there. And maybe we could work together and see how we can do the scaling up of this, because the scaling up A would require either land, or then you do hydroponics and you start going up vertical. So I don't know how you are doing this. Interesting and informative session for me as a trainer in strategic innovation. Corruption is the innovation killer. How do we handle it? You know, you don't have to handle corruption. You have to circumvent it, because there is corruption. There's corruption everywhere, and it's very hard to do it. You know, you just have to be smarter than that. Let me just tell you a very small thing that happened. You know, in 2000, when many IT companies set up, nobody had heard of IT, and in about 3 or 4 years, lots of land was purchased to build their building. So there were a lot of people. Who are politicians, who say, where did this money come from? What was the product? How did they sell without us knowing? And the fact is, the product was sent on ether. And that's exactly why they could not fathom. So I'm saying, if we are intelligent, just use technology to circumvent this. There is no other solution. Just be faster than they can run. And I think that's the only way to do it. There's another question. We are working on a agriculture supply chain with a vision to connect our kitchens to the farmers' producers directly. How can we raise funds? I don't know how much you are asking for, but there are lots of angel funds available. There's a lot of money available, and maybe you need to see the end client. Sometimes if you form even a group funding, you can possibly do this. So I would like to help you. We do have a program even in Thai called Thai Nurture, but you have my email on this on the slides, and maybe you should contact me. How are drones and AI technology improving farming productivity? Okay, what drones are doing today is they have Bluetooth, but it's an expensive technology. And I have also told you that there is a simpler technology that is available where drones are concerned. You don't need to always use drones. You can use sensors, because finally the drones are talking to sensors through Bluetooth. So unless your farming is on a great height, which is inaccessible, and you need only certain people to go there, I think only then you use drones. Otherwise, you can certainly use a sensor with a drip irrigation, which goes with RFID up to your hub. And beyond your hub, when you start going on to mobile technology, it uses your GSM. So on future trading of agriculture products like turmeric, could you explain more? You know, this has been a new thing for me, which we discovered called the TOCAM. If we are able to do this kind of future, but this is a full new study on its own. Nobody has done that, but certainly for commodities, now it's a very big deal, even overseas, where they are trading on commodities. And like I said, there's very little disruption in food, because food is the product. So I think this will be a very good time for us to see what are the products that we can actually do futures on. Some critical ones. Turmeric is like a base for all Indian food. So I think so. But I need to verify that some more myself. But if you email me, we could do this. Did you mention of an institution where innovative ideas are developed? Can you let us have its name? There is no institution so far that is just doing innovative ideas. But if there is an innovative idea, there are people to help you take that innovation through. But if you are an entrepreneur looking for innovative ideas, I think I could give you a bank of innovations that you could use, depending on which field, if it's only going to be for farming. Now, I am from Kerala. We are trying to connect dairy farmers and customers through online platform in Little. Is it possible to get a seeding investment? If you make a business plan and you put it out, please send me an email. We will certainly try and connect to our people, and I think it's a very good opportunity to do that. The next question, can you please highlight some of the recent innovations in the cold chain industry in India? You know, in the cold chain, one of the suggestions I had made many years ago, and I thought it was, in a cold chain, typically when you go from one end to the other, you are unable, you do not vault your product. Result is many times pharmaceutical companies would complain that when it reaches different cities, people keep opening the door of the deep freezer and letting out so much air that it would not last the entire journey or until the destination. So many vaccines would go bad. So I had suggested this idea of vaulting it. That means if you go to one of your lockers, you know, you have these long vaults, and if you could do that for a cold chain, you could certainly do this kind of a vaulting. The other thing, cold chains are now taking other forms as well. It's not just a cold chain. They are doing all kinds of things simultaneously. So I think that is something you may need to explore. And actually, sky's the limit. So I think that is one area when there's huge scope for. I asked the previous question on sustainable
hydroponics.
I had asked on sustainable agriculture. I'm from Kerala. In the system, I currently have aquaponics, water harvesting, and organic inputs, biogas. I think you have everything. You already are there. So
yeah.
The question is just, you just have to encash on that. Because, you know, the bottom line is whatever technology you do, it should work and it should earn you what you've started up to do. You can't have technology for the sake of technology. So it has to take you that distance. So I hope it does. And I think you're on the right track. working for women empowerment with value addition of fruit, vegetables, milk, and bee wax, how to raise funds. Again, if you make a business plan, there are people who will put in money. There are people. And in fact, even the government will put in some money. So one needs to just go to the right department. I'm quite sure Mr. Menon and Ty Kerala can help you do that as well.
Yes.
You know, I think you need to do that. The government has allocated a lot of funds for this. So, and especially beeswax and honey, all kinds of honey, because honey is the base for your or most of your Ayurvedic medicine. So I think there is opportunity there. Are you aware of a specific active international crowdsourcing collaboration forum sharing rural innovation initiatives? Actually, there are a lot of websites when one goes, and you can apply to any of them. I think what works is what suits you and what suits them. Finally, it's a buyer and a seller meet, and you need to see what works best. But I could send you some links if you are interested. Again, if you email me, I would do that. Okay, I think I've covered most of the questions that have been asked.
Any more questions, please? Yeah, we can do that. Nirmal?
Yeah, we'll share the presentations and the contact details after the
yes.
session.
Yes.
If you have any
yes.
specific question on the topic, please post it in the Q&A section rather than on the chat.
Yes. Yes.
I think, sir, we'll continue with the session if you have any questions for.
That's right.
Yeah.
I mean, what are the products Kirloskar Brothers have introduced in Kerala for the rural? We've been discussing. We talk about the bottom of the pyramid concept, focusing on the bottom of the pyramid, and that's the problem exactly we are facing, because our rural, there's no rural, no urban in Kerala for that matter. But certainly, I mean, a lot of work has to be done in the village area. So what are the things that have been done by Kirloskar Brothers?
If you could, Nirmal, just move the slides. If you can just slide them down.
Yes, yes. We will circulate that. That would be useful.
Yeah, either you circulate it or you can just glide it down. I could just talk about the slide.
Nirmal, is it possible that a particular slide?
No, I'll just tell you. Just move it down. Move two slides down. One more down. Yeah, one more. So I have one. Yeah. So that this is one. Now this is this technology on the left is done in 1986, and
yes.
it is a they call it a solar pump. You see the panels on the left. It's the source for the power. It generates this pump. It starts the pump, and the pump uses some energy, and the rest it actually can use to put back on the grid. So if you are getting credits for putting it on the grid, it's well worth it. And if you don't, then maybe you can put it in a battery and then use the battery sometime later. On the right is a
pump. How is the cost wise? It's very expensive for us.
No, the solar pump, maybe I think it may be a lakh, I'm not sure, but I could you know what, I've also given my email again there, and I'm giving you a whole little list of contact details. Please contact these people there, and Mr. Suman Chakrabarty will help
Suman,
you
yes,
through
yes.
all the prices. So I think yes. I've introduced you to him. So there are a whole range of products for a particular application. So one on the right says that for rapids. So if you have a hilly area and you have a waterfall or a short waterfall, about 18 feet, you can use this pump. It'll take that water, it passes through the pump, it becomes a turbine and generates electricity for you.
That will be very good in the plantation area, in exactly. the hilly area. And
yes.
There is a subsidy also from the government, isn't it?
That's right. Yeah, there's some subsidy as well. So this is something you can use. So if you move to the next slide, I'll tell you some more products that we have. So in this slide, I've divided the slide into two. On the left are all the applications. So one are agricultural applications. There are different applications for each kind of agricultural product.
Yes.
And there are separate pumps for them. So what is important is that you need to choose the right pump for the right application.
Okay.
On the second row, you will have you'll have things for houses. You have standalone houses. You have multi-storied houses, and there is one more small thing. There is bungalows. So again, the requirement for the pump for each of these is different. So typically, what happens is when you go to a plumber, he will just say whatever he thinks he wants to say. But I'd say is the right thing is to get the right pump for the right application. You don't want to be paying too much on electricity, and you don't want to be paying too much on the pump. You don't want an overkill.
That's
and
right.
The third, yes, the third is what we use for rainwater, for drain switch cleaning, and for harvest, dewatering in flooded areas. Now, this dewatering pump was used tremendously last year when they had floods in Kerala. And we have used this effluent treatment and sewage plants. That's the application. These are the pumps on the right. So if you move to the next slide.
The Kerala plant, paddy cultivators, they are not able to produce the required quantity. In fact, there is a productivity is very low compared to even the neighboring states. I understand you have done a good job in Cambodia.
And
for paddy cultivation. Yes.
Yes, we have. We put you see what is important is the terrain. And we are experts on that. So if you see the terrain, then we put up a system that will work for that terrain and optimize that for you. So if that is optimized, then you can put in a good irrigation system, you save your water, you save your electricity, and you get a good output. So something like that could certainly be done if that is the requirement.
Yeah.
And the next slide has got all our contact details. So one is a toll free, the one on top is Mr. Chakrabarti's number. The one below is a toll free. Yeah, it's a toll free. So any of these could be used.
We'll invite him once. Yes.
But I had a lot of suggestions for Kerala. Because when we spoke last time, you know, I said you have tea plantations, you have spices. So you could try to do the futures on spices. And I thought because it has quite a large shelf life. You know, also your pineapple farming. I don't know if you've thought of the food processing. You can also do extracts, pineapple extract. So
mobile.
That is something. Yeah. So, you know, I think that intercropping using high-tech farming, you increase the life of something. You have such a lot of coconut. Now, coconut milk products, dried coconut, or, you know, Tetra Pak of coconut water. Some of them is already here, but I'm not sure whether all of it is coming from Kerala because you may want to also enter that market. So the way I see with COVID, I think it will be a stop-start. So if that's going to happen, we need to be self-sufficient with whatever we are doing. Another thing is, there was somebody who I knew who did something in chocolates. And I suggested that why don't you make pre-mixes for desserts, for chocolates and for cakes.
Yes.
Again, what's going to happen, it is definitely change our lifestyle because we are all been at home doing work ourselves. We are used to a certain amount of cleanliness. And so sometimes it's very difficult for you to even delegate that work to somebody or someone else. But if you have packets, quick packets of mixes where you can do your own stuff, where it needs less handling, I think people would want that. You know, you also mentioned that a lot of the nurses are going to be coming back from UAE. So what happens to them? And, you know, they're all trained in very nice international protocols. They could do online videos and teaching material for other nurses. I think that is going to be a very important thing. Also, you have huge amount of temples in Kerala. So maybe temple architecture, you can help in adopt a temple aspect or adopt a monument where someone from outside comes and does an upkeep for those temples for you. So these are various things. Another thing is tea, you know. Like I spoke to you last time, I said, you know, like you have wine tasting, why can't you have a class on tea? Because not everybody knows tea. So there's such a lot of variety you have in tea. You can have chat rooms and tea sessions where you teach people what is long leaf, what is short leaf, what is blend, you know, what is how it works and how would you recognize one tea from another? What is first flush? What is second flush? So I think there is a lot of scope even in that experience.
I think so. Yeah. And you see such models in Sri Lanka. When you go to the plantation area, they give you their product. They give you, make tea for you, snacks. That's a business opportunity, as you said. Can be tried. Right. I think Tata Tea has got some outlets there in Munnar.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I think lots of these things can be done. Also, going to a tea estate could be quite a surreal experience for many people who are from urban areas. It could be a kind of tourism as well, So maybe you want to think of that. It's a good thing for tourism.
We waste a lot of our produce because of the lack of post-harvest technology here in Kerala. I think we would like to have some more information how you are tackling that in Maharashtra. I was told that you are doing a good job there. We'd like to be connected with an expert in that. The cold chain. There was one question.
So let me see how we can connect you up. But I don't think Maharashtra is so well known for their tea. But maybe Gujarat is with their very big tea. But let me try and see how we can put this together.
Yeah. Any further questions, Nirmal?
Hello. Just one question from Margaret. I added one more question from Abhijit. If you can take those two.
From whom?
From Margaret Osborne. I think she's from Germany. She's part of Thai Germany, I guess.
Are you aware of a specific active international crowdsourcing collaboration forum sharing rural innovation initiatives? Not really, but I'll look for it if that's what she wants. The other question is, what would you say about the future of mushroom farming and integrating it into fertilizer? I think mushroom
is a huge opportunity.
Yes, it's an opportunity. Several people have even tried it. In fact, there used to be Wakefield that was doing mushrooms and mushroom canning and tinning. So possibly there is an opportunity there too. So if you are doing it, you should, aren't you the one who says you already have a lot of high-tech farming? And I just said that I think you need to encash all that you've spent on it.
Farming and integrating into fertilizer production. That means she's talking about the manure.
The manure.
The mushroom waste is a good manure if you are able to decompose it and
market. But that is true for all our waste. All our waste could be converted to that. In fact, that's how you have, for green buildings, you have this concept. Whatever comes into your compound never leaves. So
that's right.
It's the same system, for farm. So whatever comes into the farm never leaves. So I just recycle it.
Any further questions?
Somebody has asked that could you give us an idea how to increase productivity for Maharashtra farmers? I was suggesting that one of the things was what you do is the pooling in. I think their lack, this productivity is completely dependent on the type of seeds they are getting and the kind of system they are using for farming and maybe the watering. I think they need to take a whole approach. This will need a big study as to what is the problem with a particular farm. Because in the same belt, there are some farmers who are doing well in this, and there are some people who are not doing so well. So I think one needs to revisit and see what exactly is happening there. I don't think there's one answer that fits all.
The approach is a little more scientific in Maharashtra. That is what, according to the soil analysis,
we do. Because we have some very good agro-based research centers here, like in Rahuri. We have for Rahuri, we have some for bamboo where they try to do tissue culture of bamboo on one side and sugar cane. And they're trying to see if they could make sugar cane as thick and big as bamboo. So there were lots of trials that were done there.
And they use a lot of micronutrients also in Maharashtra.
Yes, they do.
Yeah, so that would actually increase the production of the crops.
That's right.
Nirmal?
So there are no further questions from the participants as such.
Yes.
I can't see the questions here.
No, there are no further questions, sir. If you can just take up some of the questions that you had.
The one more question, ma'am. Any views on IBM Food Trust?
No, actually, I don't know much about IBM Food Trust.
I've been answered like. I think we answered that. It's no. Will you be able to explain about the Cambodian operations then?
You see, we worked with the local farmers, some of the institutes that were there, with a huge irrigation company and our water needs. So it was a joint effort where you work with all of them and you first take measurements of the terrain and find out what kind of terrain it is before you start doing any of that. And then you find out how you're able to get water to all these areas. Because it is not that they don't have water. It is the way sometimes even overwatering is not good for you.
Which state in India has benefited the maximum in your work? By your work?
I think in Maharashtra, we have, in the belt that we are in, we have helped. We have helped our own belt where we are currently. That's the whole sugarcane belt in Maharashtra. And we do a lot of work in Punjab and Haryana. So all the wheat growing regions we are.
Yes. Yeah.
So there's a question here which says, I don't know how to take this from technology to a business level. I have degrees in both computer science and biotechnology. I understand only technology and solutions, but not business. And how do I go about doing that? I think the fact that Mr. Abhijit has put in a lot of technology in there, maybe we should revisit this. His might be a perfect model farm for us to start work on, you know, because where are you based, Mr. Abhijit? I don't know if he's based in Kerala, but if he's based in Kerala, I think he has everything you want in a farm. So he wants now to know how to make it into a good business. So I think we need to understand what all he grows there, where he's situated, because I don't know where he's situated. And then start exploring all the markets and the supply chains there. Because I think what you really need is a good supply chain, from what I can see, that you have got everything else that a farm really needs.
Abhijit is actually based out of Wayanad in Kerala.
Oh, I see. Okay.
I see. So, you know, I think Mr. Menon, you have someone right there. I think he could.
We can. Let him get in touch with Tai. We'll help him out. We'll help him out.
Yes. I think, you know, if you do that, he will be actually a wonderful study.
Yes. Yes.
And someone has asked about Sterling Farms from Mr. Menon. I think that would be a good idea.
People wanted Sterling to know Farm. What Sterling Farm does. So if you can briefly tell about your activities also.
Yes. Yeah. You know, my company has been formed in 1987. We are into agriculture inputs, mainly for the exports. Since last about 5-7 years, we are supplying in Indian market also. But let me tell you, during the COVID time, there is a huge demand for agri products in Kerala. This is something very surprising. In fact, when I was talking to my marketing guy, he says that demand has gone doubled comparing to last month. That means everybody wants to get into agriculture. This is, we have specialty agro products like micronutrients, and water soluble fertilizer, organic, pest controlling system, all that. Company A to Z. In fact, most of the, garden centers abroad, you find our products. And we were the first to introduce cocopeat in India. That's about 27 years back. And it's very popular. And that's conditioning of the soil and as a soil substitute. More details can be given later if you're able to call me or contact us. Thank you.
Those are the questions for the participants, sir.
Then what else, Nirmal?
There is one more slide I think you had missed on some innovations in that specifically for Kerala.
No, but I mentioned this. I mentioned them.
Okay.
Great. Mentioned already.
Sure.
What is this Krishi? I mean, Kriti Rathod's
No, she has asked for the presentation. If you have any more questions for ma'am, as well as if you can post it in the Q&A section.
Yes. If there's no question.
Okay.
I lost so connection.
That's pretty much from the participants, ma'am.
So I think then we can write it up.
The presentations will be shared with all of you, including the contact details of the people from Kirloskar will be shared later on. Shudha sir, if you can conclude and...
Can I? Everything, I lost connection, I think, Nirmal.
I can hear you quite well.
Can you see me?
No, we can't see you, but we can hear you.
Okay. There's something wrong with my system here. Hello.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Pradima and Mrs. Pradima Kirloskar for your presentation. I wish that we could come. One of these days to Cochin and give a direct presentation to our people with demonstration. But there's always a limitation having virtual communication. Anyway, I'm sure that our people have enjoyed asking questions, and it's quite an interesting session it was. And we will stay in touch with you, and we will take your presentation and circulate among our members, so that if there is any further doubts they have, we'll come back to you. Okay.
Thank you.
Now, what I will do, I will get in touch with Suman.
Yes.
Your guy, because there's Gulf return people is going to be a major challenge for us in Kerala. So we want to give them employment or sort of a startups in agriculture. So even starting a homestead farming or a small, even if they have a small holding, how to make agriculture a little more interesting, creating a glamour among them. Because they all worked in Dubai, it's not that easy for us to make them come here and ask them to cultivate here. So these are the things I think you'll be able to guide us, help us in taking, this is only the beginning. We'll certainly get back to you, ma'am. Okay.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much once again.
Thank you so much. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good night.
Thank you, participants.
We'll stay in touch. Yeah.